Well, I'm Brian Collins. I'm head football coach at CW Post College in New York. We're a Division II school based on Long Island. And I'm here to talk to you about eight-man defense, the G-front package. Some people are talking about 4-2-5 defense. So I'm here today to go over our defensive package. We've been very successful with our G defense the past several years. Three out of the last 4 years, we were number one in the nation in Division II in rushing defense. And then this past year, we were number one in pass efficiency defense. So we've kind of hit both ends of the spectrum of defending the run, and then this year getting towards defending the pass. But again, what I'm here to talk to you about is stopping the run. And that's what we do best, obviously, from the last 3 years, being number one in the nation. We are an eight-man front, what we call an eight-man front. The reason for us being an eight-man front is, number one, being a Division II school, we're looking for certain type of athletes, the best type of athletes to recruit. And I think we can relate to the high school coaches in that fact that you're probably going to have a lot of good running backs types. When we recruit, we go out and we try to get the best athlete, and many times the ones that are left over are the good Division one running backs that quite didn't get that scholarship. So we take them and put them into our defense in different positions, and that's really the strength of our defense, is that we have running back types or defensive back types that can run to the football and attack. I'm trying to sell the point of the eight-man front football is the flexibility that it gives us. We face multiple offenses. We do face spread, and sometimes we're limited in what we can do versus spread offense, and we do have adjustments and answers for that. But we do see option football, we see power football, we see wing T offenses. So this package gives us the flexibility to go week to week. We also want to stop the run. That's dominant in our conference, in our area of football, being in the Northeast. We want to stop the run and have pursuit, free hitters, and limit the offensive game plan that we see. Also, what the eight-man front gives us is the ability to attack, and that's through blitzing and the schemes that we do. What I'm going to go over now is an overview of the G defense, explain the positions in the G defense, and some of their reads. If we put up an I formation, which we don't see as much I as we used to, but if we were to go over some terminology so you could understand some of the things that we're talking about, we do call them gaps, okay? A, B, C, D gap football. Okay? Now, when we do talk about alignments, we do talk alignments as numbers, okay? We go inside shade would be number one, head up two, outside shade of guard three. Inside shade of the tackle would be a 4-I, head up would be a 4, and the outside shade of the tackle would be a 5, okay? Inside shade of the tight end would be a 7, head up would be a 6, outside shade would be a 9. And so that's how we relate to our different types of techniques and shade on the different linemen. Now, if you were a linebacker, all you would do is to take that number and put a 0 at the end. So if I was an outside shade on the guard, I would be a 30 technique. Okay, our front is set. Our four down linemen we call the open side end. In a 5 technique, the evil. Okay, we call our 1 technique, shading inside the guard, our nose, our three technique is called a tackle, and our inside technique on the tight end, our other defensive end, which is in a seven technique, is called our SAM. So those are our four down linemen. Now, if we were going to talk about what we're looking for in these four down linemen, okay, if we took our ends, okay, we would say the quicker pass rushing type of end would be our five technique end. He's a guy that, again, could be a running back type in at the lower level. He doesn't have to be a big type of kid. We've been fortunate to get good size there. It also has good speed, but our five technique could be the lesser of the two. The seven technique is more of a plugger type guy that's going to face some down blocks and some double teams, so he's got to be a little bit thicker. Now, that doesn't mean to say that we flip-flop our guys. You can flip-flop, okay, to get your matchups. You can play your evil into the boundary and your SAM to the field. We in the past have just played left-right because they feel comfortable, and if there is a tight end trade, it doesn't really hurt us. They've learned both techniques. Our inside people, our tackles, our nose guard, again, doesn't have to be the big type of guy. He could be a smaller inside interior lineman that's very good quickness, gets off the ball low, and runs to the football very well. Okay, our tackle, our three technique tackle, is going to be a bigger type player. He's going to face a lot more double teams and down schemes, and we need him to be a little bit bigger so he doesn't get washed into the linebackers or down the line of scrimmage. So that would be our front as far as our defensive line. Now, our inside backers, and this is the reason why a lot of them call it a 4-2-5 defense nowadays, but we are still calling it an 8-man front, 4-4. Okay, our backer lines up inside of the tackle at 4.5 yards. Okay, he's considered a 40-eye player. Okay, inside eye of the tackle at 4.5 yards. Our MAC linebacker is going to be stacking our nose guard. He's going to be in what we call a 10 technique. Now, when we're talking about these two players, okay, the backer linebacker could be the smaller type linebacker, the one that can scrape. He is going to be covered up. He doesn't face a lot of one-on-one schemes in the blocking technique. He's more of a scrape type linebacker that many times is untouched. The MAC linebacker is more of your true big physical type linebacker, your downhill type of linebacker that plays against pressing the center techniques and some ISO type looks. Okay, as we moved to our outside linebacker types, we have our strike and what we call our whip. Some people call it a rover. Okay, we call it a whip. They are aligned at 4.5 yards also. Okay, our strikes alignment can be anywhere from 4.5 to 4 to 5 yards off the tight end side. If number two is split, we just have to decide, do we want him 1 yard outside of that split number two receiver, or if he's trying to pull us out of that box area, we feel him pulling us out, we'll take an inside alignment off number two strong. But, we can play around with his alignment. As the same as the whip, he's usually aligned in the apex of the tackle box and the one weak receiver. These are boundary players. Our whip is a boundary player. Okay, and our strike is a field player. We just feel that's a little bit more, it's easier to find one of those guys. Maybe a little bit more quick. It can cover a number two receiver in man-to-man situations a little bit better. Works a little bit better in space. So again, what we're talking about is maybe he's more of a defensive back type. Again, a running back type. He could be maybe an inside linebacker type guy. If you can get a defensive back, a safety type, that's ideal. Okay. Now, again, he can line up in any type of formation. He's in his hit position now. He could be in a walk position, which is outside. Bang is even further out. Okay. Or if we want to get him inside, we'll get him more into a hit type of position for him. Those are our two alignments. Again, the reason we're playing this at our level is that they're running back types. They're the best athletes that we can recruit. And often you could put a running back one, two, three, possibly a fullback here, all right, and something here. So you have guys that can run, good athletes that can run in space and pursue the football, all right, which leads us to our secondary. Okay, we have two corners, all right. One of them is definitely a field corner for us. One's a boundary corner. Again, running this defense, you don't need the great defensive back types. It's hard for us, being Division II, to recruit a defensive back out of high school. I think it's important that you see them in person. It's very hard to see them on film when you evaluate them. And often, if you can get a real good one, you're very lucky. So it does limit the number of defensive backs that you do need in your defense. Okay, we have two corners. Again, our field corner and our boundary corner. If you're fortunate to have two great corners, just put them left and right, and which leads us to a free safety. Now, our corners, and I'm going to talk about our base coverage here just for a little bit, and then I'll get back to coverages later, but our base coverage is a robber coverage, which we call cover eight. And so our corners' initial alignment is going to be anywhere from 1 yard inside to 2 yards inside and 9 yards deep. Okay, again, 1 yard to 2 yards inside and 9 yards deep. Our free safety, who's really the ninth man in the box in our run support, in our cover eight, our robber coverage, he could be aligned in the B gap to passing strength, and he could be anywhere from 8 yards to 10 yards to if you want to move him back to 12, because people just can't get away with putting him up there early, move him back to 12. All right, we have had him played at 8 yards, very effective. We've moved him back to 12, and we didn't lose his effectiveness. So whichever way you feel comfortable with. Now, that's the overview of the personnel that we're looking for. I would say that if you could get these types of players, you could pretty much plug, you know, the same type of player into four or five positions on this defense. Again, this is why we play it, and we've been successful in stopping the run with it. With our defense, okay, the first thing we want to talk about when we talk about defensive line play is our stance. You know, I don't want to get into specifics of our stance, but what often the argument that you'll hear is which hand do you even put down? Okay, what we do is we are shading, we're a shade defense, okay, everybody has a gap to control, so we want to put down the hand down to the man we're shading, our gap hand down. Okay, so for example, all right, our seven technique, okay, he's going to have his left hand down, okay, in this case. Our three technique, okay, he'll have his right hand down, okay, and his right foot back, and so forth. He'll be in a right-handed stance, and he'll be in a left-handed stance. Now, the reason for this, okay, many people say, Coach, you know, and there's an argument to it. We put people on the right-hand side, we want the ball hand down so they can see that ball, and, you know, they would all be in a right-handed stance, and there's credit to that, but what we feel is this, okay? If I'm shading a man, okay, I want his hand down to the man I'm shading, okay? If I'm shading inside of a tight end, my left hand down. The reason being is this. When you talk to the great offensive line coaches, they don't talk about their first step, all right? That's a step that they take for granted. They'll talk about a first step for maybe 2 hours, but the real good ones, the real great offensive line coaches, they always talk about the second step. And that's what we're concerned about. We know we're going to work our takeoff drills, our get-off drills with our defensive linemen. They're attacking. We're going to get that first foot on the ground. It's can we get our second foot on the ground? And to be in a position to get that second foot on the ground, we just feel that our man that we're shading hand, the gap hand down, is the one that we want down. So that's how we are in our stance. Okay. Now, our defensive line, okay, their D-line reads. Okay. Number one. Man on, okay? We want to read the man on our football, and I'll get to that a little bit later. Number two, we're talking about near back, okay? And number three, ball inside. All right, that makes it easy for our guys. Our defensive line coach knows, guys, I'm talking about your reads. Number one, man on. Number two, near back. Number three, ball inside. We're reading a triangle as a defensive lineman. Now, what we talk about on man on, there's two things when we talk about man on. Number one is our visual key. All right, our defense is based upon reacting to movement. Okay, and we're going to be watching something. We're going to see the ball, we're going to see our man, and we're going to react to movement. So that's our visual key. The second thing we talk about with our players, okay, is a pressure key. All right. That's what they're feeling, okay? So we're seeing something, we're reacting to it, and the pressure key comes in right after that visual key. You're going to get your pressure key. You need to understand the pressure key in order to play effective defensive line football. So if I'm talking about my seven technique, all right, our visual key will actually not be the man we're shading, but the hip of the offensive tackle. Okay, that's our visual key. Our pressure key will be the tight end. All right, we're going to feel that tight end, but we're watching that defensive tackle's hip. Okay, our three technique is shading the guard. That's obviously his visual key. His pressure key would be the offensive tackle. Our nose guard is shading the guard, and so his visual key will be that guard with his pressure key being the center. And our end, our five technique, the same as our seven technique. Again, I said, you know, we have the same technique. If there's a tight end there, there's a tight end there. Doesn't make much difference to us, though. Okay? Our visual key will be that hip of that tackle. Okay? And if you're on the open end side, your pressure key will probably be in the backfield. Okay? Which is also your secondary and your near back. Okay? So that's what we're talking about on defensive line play. What is our visual key? Okay? What is the man in front of me doing? How am I going to react to it? Now, we are not a reacting, read type defense. We're rushing. We're attacking type defense. We're reading on the run, okay? All of our players are in a great stance, a great takeoff stance, and we're coiled, ready to strike out, okay? We want those players in a stance that's a bit uncomfortable for them, all right? One thing I couldn't understand was defensive line coaches that say, get in your stance, I don't care what stance it is, be comfortable. We want our players uncomfortable so they can get out of their stance quick, okay? So as we take it along, all right, the first block that we have to defeat, obviously, is a base block. All right, we talk about that, and I'll just go to some of the top three that we do see in this defense. Again, you only see a different certain number of types of blocks in this defense because you're gap related. We have the base defense, base block. We have the reach, you know, and we have, you know, a double or a combo. You know, both of those work for us. All right, and we'll talk a little bit about each one of them. Again, the aiming points of our defensive lineman. I want to go through the shoulder of the man I'm shading. Okay, I'm controlling my gap, but at the same time, I'm going through the shoulder of the man that I am shading. What we talk about is get on the other line of scrimmage. You want to go through the shoulder and out the back. Okay, we're not going around blocks. We're going through the shoulder and out the back. Hey, we're going to collapse down. If there's down blocks going, we're going to bend. We're a bending, attacking type of front defense. Okay, if I'm a five technique and I get a base block, okay, which we don't see that all that often, maybe on an ISO play to that side, I'm going to get off the ball. I'm going to attack that inside shoulder and compress that block and lock out. I don't want to get too much into the specifics of defensive line play, but I do want to tell you what we're doing on each block. Okay, so that's a base block, is that we're going to defeat that block. We're going to compress the gap. We put the lineman back where he came from and keep attacking that shoulder. Okay, if that hip goes down, okay, we'll see the down scheme a lot from our offensive tackles. Again, if that hip goes down, I'm tripping over the heels of the offensive lineman. I'm bending down also. Okay, I'm cocked, ready to go. I'm reading that hip. That's my visual key. As soon as that visual key goes down, I'm tripping over the heels of offensive lineman. Okay, I'm bending downhill fast, going to my next read, which would be near back to ball inside. Okay, that's what that man is doing. Okay, if I get some type of reach block, okay, some type of reach block, then on a reach block, we're just going to fight the head. We want to try to keep our head to the outside helmet plate of the offensive tackle, work our way upfield, steering upfield, trying to turn his shoulder. Okay? We want to get a push. We just don't want him to get outside and reach us. We've played with a wide five technique, and that's okay. And when you put him a little bit wide and cock him in, like you'll see a lot of eight-man fronts do, you'll see a lot more ISO and a little bit more stress on the defense. We feel with a great get-off, we don't need to be that wide. Okay, we do see a lot of option. We don't like them to be so wide on option football. You'll see later on, it kind of slows down the read for the inside linebacker. So we'll play there, right on his hip, and we'll just fight that reach block. And we don't have to defeat it. We just have to stalemate it and get it way upfield. Okay, we do have, again, nine people running to the football. It's very important he doesn't get reached. If he's getting reached, it's not going to be because of his alignment. It's going to be because of his technique. He has a poor get-off. So we'll play the reach block. As well. Those are the type of blocks you'll see from that five technique. Now, as we move into the inside, again, you know, when we're talking about a base block, and we don't see too many base blocks, we see a lot of zone schemes, but if we do get a base block, we're going to defeat it. It's something we do day one with our defensive line, is playing against that sled and beating the base block. This nose guard is going to go through the shoulder and out the back, okay, all the while controlling A gap and reading on the run. Okay, if he gets any type of reach block, okay, again, by his alignment and by his get off, he shouldn't be getting reach. He's going to fight that head, you know, steer the shoulder, turn the shoulder, and work his way upfield. Okay, what we must have in this defense is a chip block, okay, or that combo block on that nose guard to keep our MAC linebacker free. You know, that's something we have to have. If that nose guard is being blocked one-on-one by that guard's reaching him and controlling him, we have a problem in our defense, okay? Again, he doesn't have to be the biggest guy to do it. He just needs to be quick so that they demand that at least they're going to chip on him up to the backer, okay? If we do get that combo, okay, we don't want him fighting both, okay? And some people say we want to split that. Oh, we do want to split that, but the first thing is when we're facing some kind of double or a combo, we'll play both the same, is that we'll beat the man that we're shading, the man that's in charge of us. We beat our visual key. Okay, so what we want to do is play that combo like a reach block, okay, beat your visual key. When you feel pressure, you start turning your hips towards your pressure key, okay? By turning your hips, you're creating a bubble for him to get up onto the linebacker. Very difficult job to do is to get across his hips onto our MAC linebacker, who's a big, strong, pressing-type linebacker. Again, if we're facing some type of double or combo, beat your visual key. Treat it as a reach block. Start working your hips and turn your hips towards your pressure key and let him have to really work to get up to the next level, okay? Or at least stay on you. Now you have both on him. You've done your job. You're trying to split that, work as hard as you can with that butt inside the gap and splitting the gap and working your way upfield. Okay, that's a very common block for us. We work on it very much during the week. Okay, and we do a good job of getting in there, not getting reached, working our hip around and trying to split it with our hip, all the while occupying the center's block so he can't chip onto our MAC linebackers fast. Again, we're not asking him to eat those blocks. Okay, we're not asking him. We want our defensive linemen to make plays. Okay, two of the 3 years we were rushing defense, number one, we had two of our defenders in the top five in the country in tackle for losses, and they were defensive linemen. Okay, these guys make plays in the backfield. These guys have tackle for losses. The linebackers very, very rarely are going to get tackle for losses if they're not in a blitz technique. So we want them making plays. Okay, we're in the nose guard facing a back block from the center. Again, we want to read that center block. Okay, we're attacking that guard. Okay, we're getting off. We're getting our charge going. Ball snap, we're reacting, guard pulls to the inside, now goes to our pressure key. All right, if our pressure key, the center, is real shallow and trying to cut us off, we'll try to work across the face. Remember, we want this boy making plays. If we have to slow down our MAC linebacker because he's at a face across the face player, and then we'll do that in our scouting report, okay? But many times, we'll just try to beat this upfield because we'll have a MAC playing opposite A-gap, and so we'll try to beat that and make a big play into the backfield. Those are the blocks that you'll see from the nose guard, really. You'll see the base block very rarely. We'll see a lot of combo blocks in the zone scheme and a lot of double teams. And again, we're going to defeat our visual key on that and turn our butt to the pressure key. And we do see some of that center back block. When we get scooped to the weak side, not many teams, again, when you're playing this eight-man front, not many teams will run weak side because we've got an extra defender here to play that, and he's an unblocked defender. So we don't see many reach schemes to the open side, but if we do, obviously because of his alignment, he's already going to get reached. What we want him to do, though, is to take that reach block. Don't let the center, you know, cut him off, the cutoff block from the center. Make this guard your guy. Just have a claw technique. As he tries to reach, let him propel you to the outside and away from the center. So we don't see that block often, but it is something that we do work on. As we go to the tackle, our three technique, he's the bigger guy, okay? Do we see a base block? Sometimes, not often. If we see a wham team, an ISO team, somebody wants to run A-gap on us, which we feel we defend very well, we may see that. Often it's going to take two to block this three technique. But if we do see that base block, again, in a great stance, going through the shoulder of our visual key and out the back, reading on the run, okay, compress that gap, own that B gap, if we do get that drive block. Quite often, what we'll see, again, is a combo type of block, or, you know, we'll see the reach block and then combo on our seven technique. So it depends on what type of players you have here. But on our three technique, if we're getting that reach block, again, we're fighting the head by our alignment and by our get off, our takeoff, we should not be getting reached. Okay, again, part of the defense is predicated on these two having to block this one player. That's the same as a nose guard. If you have a three technique that's getting reached by the guard, it's time to get maybe a smaller, quicker guy in there, all right? But we want that big physical guy in there, and by his alignment and by his get-off, he should not be getting reached. If he is getting a reach block, he's just going to work his way upfield, turn that shoulder, and open up an alley for people to run through as he's getting penetration, okay? If they do combo onto him or double onto him, again, we want to defeat our visual key and get our butt working towards our pressure key. All right, try to split that double team, but at the same time, control your visual key, lock it out. Start working our butt, again, towards that tackle, making it hard for him to combo up onto a linebacker. Okay, many times what we'll try to see is that he'll just stay on this as he works his butt around, and this guy will go to our backside linebacker, and we'll get a great one run through at that point. Knowing the defense, we have an unblocked linebacker here. If we get to the seven technique, it is a little bit different in the fact that his first step is into the tight end. But that's the only difference between the seven technique and a five technique. Our seven technique is stepping towards a tight end. At the same time, he's reading his visual key. Again, if he sees that visual key go down, he becomes a tremendous bend player. Okay? We do not worry about the fact that we're getting two down blocks. Okay? If we're getting a down from this tackle and a down from this tight end, we're not going to worry about, we just don't want him to get washed all the way down. But once he sees that down block by the tackle, he's bending. Okay? Again, knowing what's behind him with an outside force player, an inside scrape player, and a robber safety, an alley fill robber safety, he's not a big factor on that down block. Okay? What we want to do is for him to close it up and get penetration and blow up the mesh point of the quarterback. All right? So once that tackle goes down, I'm down. Often we'll see now, we don't see many of the arc block that we used to see at one time. At one time, we used to get this, you know, arc block on our outside linebacker. He's down, and we'd get some kind of kick or a wrap on an offensive lineman. Because of the reading technique of our seven, by bending and awfully destroying the plays, we don't see that blocking scheme much anymore. Okay, I haven't seen it in a couple of years, matter of fact. What we often see is maybe a combo block on that seven technique. Again, he's going to treat that as a reach block. Okay, he's going to work his way, defeat his visual key, and work his way, his butt towards the pressure key, trying to split it upfield, and keeping his butt in the path of the tight end, trying to block down, chip off on our inside linebacker. So what we're doing, to put it in a brief summation, is these four down linemen, okay, and many of our defensive fronts are playing the same techniques, and they're playing real fast and attacking defense. They're reading the man in front of them, they're going through his shoulder. As he goes down, we're bending and bouncing plays to the outside. When you talk about our salmon end, a question often asked is, do we wrong arm? And the principle is there. Yes, in a term of us going underneath that block, we do it. But to say the terminology of wrong arming is out of our playbook right now. I don't think on a high school level or in the college level, players like to come underneath a block and hit it with their shoulder. I think they want to be more physical with that. We want those guys not absorbing a block. We want them taking on the block, destroying the block, and making a play. So what we'll tell our players, our defensive ends, as we bend and we get to our next key, whether it's the near back or one of these pulling guards from the inside, is to hit it face up, right in the V of the neck, okay, and bubble it up towards the goal line. So if we're getting some kind of power kick play, all right, well, we're getting down, okay, say he's arc blocking, and say this guard's pulling, We're going to meet it here and then take it upfield with us. Really make that ball bounce to the outside where we get our pursuit and our attacking defense. Basically, that's a quick overview of the defensive line, and we'll move back to the linebackers. Okay, to move on to our inside linebackers, again, our alignments. Our backer, the smaller of the two, the scraper, is in a 40-eye technique at 4.5 yards. Okay, our Mac linebacker is stacked behind the nose. He's in a 1 alignment. He's in a 10 technique. Add a 0 to it, and that's our alignments for the back of the Mac. Again, the backer being the smaller, quicker-type linebacker, that's a scrape-type player, him being the more natural, big, inside, true middle linebacker. Okay? When we talk about our alignments, we talk about our gap control, what gaps we're controlled of, all right? These guys are not numbered. They don't use letters. They use numbers, okay? We call him a 91 player, and he a 31 player. What we mean by a 91 player, backer gets flow to him. He's a 9-gap player. When we number our gaps for the linebackers, it's 1, 3, 5, and 9, okay? So he's going to step here on flow to his side. He's responsible for the D gap, the 9 gap, okay? On flow away from him, okay, he's a 1-gap player, all right? Flow away from him, he's got A gap, what we call 1-gap. If you just want to keep it A gap and D gap, that's fine with us, but we don't want to get him caught up in so much letters, as much as numbers for these guys. When we talk about the Mac, if he gets flow to his side, he's a 3-gap player, that's his gap of responsibility. On flow away, okay, he's got opposite A-gap. That's 1 gap for him, okay? And now you see how we fit in. You could actually play with a 5-yard chain around each one of their angles, okay? It flows to this side, okay? They should be moving in unison. Flow to this side, they've got their gap of responsibility. In our run support, in our cover 8 rule, we have reads for our linebacker. Okay. Our linebackers read flow. Okay. We're taught on the snap of the ball to take a short trigger step. Now, we used to call it a shuffle step, but people had a problem with a shuffle step from a linebacker. It's something they didn't want to hear a linebacker coach saying, we're going to shuffle. Okay. Because many times they'll shuffle and they'll stay into their shuffle, or a shuffle will turn into a hop and then they don't make plays. What we call it now is a trigger step. And we felt that just a better terminology, better word for our linebacker to hear is a trigger. They know after the trigger, an explosion is going to happen. Okay? So they'll each have a trigger step based upon their flow. After they get their flow reads, okay, that's just for that first trigger step, their next step and their technique that they'll use after that next step is based on their underkeys. Okay, when I talk about underkeys, we used to talk about the offensive line's blocking schemes. Okay, but as we get into selling this attacking type defense, many times our underkeys actually turn into our defense alignment. How are our defense alignment reacting to a play, and where do we fit off of our defense alignment? So flow reads, okay, to talk about different flows, all right? The first flow that we're talking about is fast flow, okay? Fast flow. Both of these backs are coming out of the chute fast. Okay, that's fast flow. What we're going to do in this case is we're going to trigger. We see fast flow. We're going to cross over, run, and run downhill. So if we're getting fast flow to the backer's side, obviously he's going to trigger, cross over, and run downhill, remaining inside out of the halfback. Okay, and I stress halfback because what our guys often do is they try to run out there and beat that fullback. And what they'll do is overrun and over-pursue the football. We want to stay inside out the halfback. This man is not going to block us, all right? In this scheme of things, he's probably going to block our outside run support, okay? Or if we're getting cracked on, he's going to block an outside cornerback. So we're not involved with him. We want to stay inside out of the halfback, okay? Many times it'll be a pulling guard. We feel we're more athletic, we've got our trigger step, we're crossover running, we'll beat that pulling guard. So our backer's job, again, trigger, crossover run. Our Mac linebacker, he'll trigger, he'll see fast flow, and many times There'll be a guard pulling. He'll see an open window. Okay, we will allow our Mac linebacker to run underneath that open window. Okay, if you see fast flow, you trigger, you see a space open, you can run. What you're doing when you're running under, okay, is many times because of our force player and our alley fill player, we'll get a great cutback, and that's where that Mac will run right into that cutback lane. Okay, if we've gotten fast flow away, okay, we just reverse it again. We don't see as much to this weak side because we do have an outside linebacker sitting there, okay? But if we do see fast flow away, again, he'll trigger, open up, and number one, if he sees us open, he can run underneath it. We do have a force player, okay? So he can go through his three gap. If he's getting some kind of down block and he's bending, we'll just go opposite the defensive lineman. Okay, it's called a natural X responsibility, and get outside and chase. Again, the backside inside linebacker is permitted to run through and take care of the cutback lane. All right, that's fast flow from the linebackers. The next type of flow we may see is what we call full flow. Okay, full flow. What we mean by full flow is we're getting downhill right now from both backs. Okay. This is a play that people will try to run against the G defense, okay, is to try to attack the bubble in the G defense, the eight-man front. Try to attack this A-gap here, okay? If we see full flow, this is the only time that the back has flowed to a side that won't trigger and go outside. There's no reason to go outside. He's going to run downhill into that A-gap versus full flow. We've got trigger and downhill, okay? This Mac is getting the same. He's got flow opposite. He's going to trigger and get downhill. They'll both run into the A-gap. Okay? We've got gap control here. We're both in the A-gap. We have a hit linebacker being patient for any type of bounce back or cut back lane. Now, to get into our techniques that we use, when we do face full flow, okay, what technique do we use as far as our body technique? Full flow is what we call a force technique, okay, force technique. That technique is the old-fashioned, use a shoulder and the flipper, okay, and to blow it up. We only use our shoulder pads taking on a block from a linebacker if it's against a back, okay? In this case, it's the fullback running the ISO or the wham, we call it, okay? We're going to meet it in the backfield. He's going to take it on with his inside shoulder. He's going to take it on with his inside shoulder, and we're going to device it up for the free safety if it does squeak through. All right, at that point in time, we use our force technique, we use our shoulder, forearm lift to blow up the fullback, okay? If we get full flow to the Mac side, all right, we're seeing an ISO or a wham, okay, we just have to, again, we got a trigger step going this way. It's full flow. He will start to press the line of scrimmage. Okay, next is his under keys. How are they blocking, or how are my defensive linemen reacting to their blocks? If we're getting some type of base block, okay, that is an open window. We fill it with our force technique. Fill it with our force technique, take it on with our shoulder pad. This point, we will take it on with our outside shoulder. Outside shoulder. All right, we don't have a problem with this. This is why. We're taking on this fullback with our outside shoulder. We want that ball to try to squeeze out to our whip linebacker. Okay, we don't want to turn it inside to our Mac, because if they are blocking like this, okay, we have all the angles. You're turning it back to somebody that might be getting blocked. Better to turn it to the person that is unblocked. Okay, so again, if we're seeing full flow in that gap, we're taking it on with our outside shoulder. What happens if they want to run the ISO more like a kick play? All right, you may get full flow that way, where they're going to down on our Mac. Well, again, you've got your flow, you've triggered two under keys. My defensive end is going to bend and take that B gap. I trigger and trip over the heels of my five technique end nice and tight and take his C gap. All right, that's called a scrape technique. All right, we'll get into that versus different flow. The backside linebacker, okay, in this type of defense, All right? He's using his backside technique, which is a press technique. He's going to take that offensive lineman, use his hands, and try to press him back into the gap where he came from. All right? Almost like a reach technique to a defensive lineman. Okay? Keep your hips clear. Use your hands for separation. Stay back till the ball's committed to the line of scrimmage. Then use your escape technique and make a play. The third flow we talk about with our inside linebackers, okay, is split flow. Okay, split flow is same side but at different levels. Okay, same side but different levels. Different than fast, different from flow. They're going the same side, but we might be getting some kind of, you know, a 6-inch read step from the halfback. We're getting some kind of fast flow from the fullback where he's going to kick somebody. All right, so we're getting split flow. Again, what we want to do on our split flow, trigger to the side of the split flow. He's going to take his D-gap responsibility. We don't know what's going on over here. We think we know. People are crashing. He's going to take a scrape technique. All right, trip over the heels of the 7 technique. Keep it nice and tight. Often, when we're getting a down scheme and we have a scrape technique from a linebacker, what we often see is his scrape takes him too wide, and there creates an alley between the Sam, our defensive end, and the inside linebacker, and the free safety is overrun it because he's taking his proper alley fill. The strike is there forcing a play, and there's no cutback people. All right, so what we want him to do, again, if he's really getting washed, that 7 technique, he's almost coming downhill. Okay, but he's got to fit nice and tight off the 7 technique in his scrape technique. Then he reacts to the other keys that may be coming. If you're getting a pulling guard, we'll go underneath that. We're an inside-out player. Inside-out player. We allow our linebackers freelance by one terminology. Open windows, we will fill. Scrape doors, we'll close. So that's what they're taught the first day. Fill open windows, scrape closed doors. So if there's some kind of opening, we'll take it, we'll fill it underneath, and bounce it to the outside. The backside linebacker versus flow away, he's in his press technique. Okay, often he's going to press that center. Again, put the center back where he came from, keep his hips clear, play the cutback, then shed and go. The last technique that we talk about, the last flow, is divided flow from our linebackers. Okay? They've gone different ways, okay, divided. What our linebackers do in divided, there is no trigger step, okay? They'll just fire their feet and get right back to their next read, their under keys, okay? It's been divided. What can they do on divided flow, okay? To us, it's either pass or draw, okay? We'll fire our feet and read our under keys. We see hi-hats, we see pass rushing moves, we start getting into our drops, which we'll talk about in a little while. Get into your drops, read draw on your third step, turn your head back to the quarterback, ensure draw is there, and then get into our drops. Okay? If it's draw, we get up there and we hit that pulling guard, whatever lineman's in charge of blocking us, it could be a center, and we're just giving it a press it up technique and give that running back a two-way go. Okay? So we'll talk about that later in linebacker play. That's divided flow. Fire your feet. The last one we talk about is our rock step. That's divided flow that turns into split flow, okay, which I'm talking about is counter. Okay, so we get divided flow. They fire their feet or they may trigger. If they do trigger, they've got to get their next read, under keys. Maybe it's pulling guards, they say. All right, when we see a guard pull to the inside, we give a pull call, okay, pull, and we will rock step back where we came from, and then we react to our reads. He becomes a scrape player. He becomes an underneath fill player for the counter. Now, one thing with a counter, okay, let me just clean this up a bit, because we do see counter versus this front, and we're able to fend it very well. We'll get counter this way to the tight end side. All right, that's what we see more of. Okay. Once we rock step or divide, we rock step the wrong way, and we come back, we do want to turn to the outside. We hear a pull call. OK? Okay, we hear a pull call. We're going to get our eyes outside and get back to our D-gap responsibility. This man is bending and crashing down. Okay, we're probably getting a scoop onto this Mac. This Mac linebacker, very important that he does not try to get across the face of any of this. He's allowed to fit right underneath those down blocks. Okay, because often we'll see the nice tight counter that's going probably into the A-gap nowadays. So he's going to come underneath that block, and that's how we'll defeat the counter. Okay, so in a nutshell, we've talked about defensive line play. Now we're back into our inside linebackers. They're flow type players, they're trigger step players, reading their under keys, and then we'll move to outside linebackers. Move into our outside linebacker play. Again, our outside linebackers are anywhere from 4.5 yards outside the tackle, the end man on the line of scrimmage. They could be splitting the difference. You could put them in different areas that you'd want them to. I will say this, however, okay, we rather have them too wide than too tight. Many times, again, what we're seeing in this scheme of things, because we're so attacking up front and bouncing things outside, people are going to the stretch play, the lead zone play. And what we want to do is, if by being too tight, we don't have that force angle that we want. So, you know, I would start them wider and then try to get them moved in more than to start them out too tight. So wider is better than tight for all purposes in our run defense. Okay. Now, what our strikes are looking for. We read lane of ball with our outside linebackers. Our strike and whip, our lane of ball reads. What is lane of ball? It's the quarterback. All right, it's the quarterback. We have to differentiate, is he in lane of ball, lane one, lane two, lane three, or lane four? Okay, that's lane of ball reads. Okay, ball in one lane. Okay, quarterback is in one lane. Okay, to us, that is a run type situation. Okay, he's either coming down the line of scrimmage in an option, or he's taken the ball and tossed it and remained on the line of scrimmage. That is ball in the one lane. Okay, lane of ball, and then we get to our second read. Everybody has their second read on the run, which is off number two. Okay, in this case, we number from outside, one, two. In this case, one, two. All right, that would be lane of ball. Is the quarterback, and next would be number two. So then that side would be one, that side would be two. All right, now, ball, again, is in lane one. It's either toss or option. We are force players. Our outside linebackers are force players. Now, don't make the mistake of calling it contain. Okay, we've had that before. Kids go in there and say, "Coach, I turned it inside," okay? And what he did, yes, he did turn it inside, but he left such a huge alley, we couldn't stop the run. What we want to call it is force. We want to force the issue. We want to alter the path of the ball. Okay? Again, why we want to be a little bit wider than a little bit inside tighter is our force lane. Okay? We see ball in the one lane, we know it's run all the way. That's a run shot for us, okay? If it was a play action, some kind of dive pass, we wouldn't have pass responsibility anyway, okay? But our force, we're coming to the line of scrimmage in a downhill fashion. Our aiming point would be the hip of that fullback, okay? I'm coming off the hip of that fullback. I want to meet that ball. I want to force the ball. I want to alter the course of the ball. As a strike, if it was option, we would be responsible for pitch, and we'll get into option play a little later. But if I were to strike and I have ball in the one lane and it was option, I would come to the line of scrimmage downhill and then I'd slow play the pitch. Okay? If it's toss or sweep, I'm coming downhill and I'm hitting that fullback's outside hip right here in the backfield. Okay? No more than 3 yards deeper in the backfield. I don't want to get any deeper than 3 yards. I want to take on that block. Now, by forcing it, okay, you're squeezing the play. Okay, we don't want our strong safety to attack the line of scrimmage that way, all right? You're opening up too big of an alley. If I hit it here and the ball bounces outside, I've done my job. I've forced the issue. I've bounced it outside for our free safety to rally to. Okay? So let's just keep that in mind. When you do talk about it, don't talk about it in contain. Talk about it as forcing the issue. Okay? That's ball in the one lane. Ball in the two lane. For us, we don't know that. That's not a clear determination what the play is. Ball in the two lane could be either run or pass. It could be, you know, a quarterback coming out, ball's in the two lane. It could be a run play, could be lead zone, okay, could be stretch, or it could be some type of play action. Okay? We do have to get to our next read after that. Okay? Lane of ball to read number two. In the strikes case, it's the tight end. If it is run, if he's showing some type of blocking scheme, an arc block on him, which we don't see often, okay, if we do see it, you know, we're just going to force it back into the inside. Or if he's blocking our seven technique, okay, now we know it's run. We're being patient players. In lane of ball, in two, run or pass, we don't know what it is, we'll be patient players. Often what we do, tell our players to do is just bounce. Okay, just bounce until we determine what number two is doing. Okay? Now, in this instance, okay, ball's in the two lane, all right, and it is run. It's been determined run. Obviously, it's not an outside run, but it can turn into an outside run by the way our people are playing it, by bouncing it outside. So we have a rule. We have an imaginary 5-yard fence rule for our outside linebackers. You cannot come inside that fence to make a play. Okay? What these guys will do often is they see it's run, they bounce, they start attacking the line of scrimmage, and our great benders and inside linebackers playing inside out will bounce that play to the outside, and they'll get out-leveraged, and that guy will be gone. Okay? So what we want to tell our players is you're patient, patient. The ball's inside. You will have to go around that fence to make a play. That's a save play. They're not making a tackle for a loss. They're not in on the play. They've done their job. They've stayed outside. Everybody else has done their job. We might have missed a tackle, though. Okay, they'll come inside and fold under that 5-yard fence rule and make that play. That ensures that they're not going to get out-leveraged by a ball that bounces outside because of the pursuit. Okay? If we get lane of ball is 3, well, obviously, we consider that a pass. We just have to determine, as outside linebackers, is it 3-step or 5-step? Because that's going to determine my exit point. So we get lane of ball in the 3-lane. We open up immediately to the outside of the flat. We get into our drop. We get our head turned. We ensure that's not 3-step. If it is 3-step, we immediately find the number one receiver and break to his inside, his outside shoulder, underneath to make a play, to make a pick. I'll get into coverage in a little while with the ball in the lane in the 3-lane. Okay, but ball lane 3 is a pass, and I get to my number 2 read, which is the tight end, and he will determine what I have in cover 8, which I'll get to in a sec. Okay, we didn't talk much about the whip. The whip, again, is the same as the strike with his lane of ball. He's forcing any type of weak toss. We don't see it often. Okay, what we will see is maybe a crack. Okay, and that's when we'll get into our defensive back play. Okay, we play our free safety at 12 yards. We had played him in the past at 8 yards. We thought it was just a little bit too shallow. He did a good job of run support, but we felt he wasn't a downhill player enough. He was more of a scrape player. We really want him to be a downhill, alley fill type of player. So we have moved him back to 12. You can move him back to 10. 12 had worked well for us. He will be your second leading tackler on the football field. The backer often is our number one tackler. The free safety is often our number two tackler. His alignment, he goes to passing strength in the B gap. Okay. Now, if number two is split out, if this is not a tight end, it's a slot, we'll try to maintain him in the box. He is the ninth man in the box. Okay, we'll try to maintain him in the B gap. But if he has to move out a little bit, then we'll work with him just a couple of steps outside of that. But we try to maintain B gap relationship with him depending on what the formation is. Okay, we used to want to make this look like cover 3, but we really weren't fooling anybody. So now we make everything look like our cover eight, our robber coverage. Okay. Our corners are again 2x9 or 1x9 inside. Okay, I will go over the free safety first. Our free safety, okay, he's a run support player. He is reading number two. If number two is blocking, okay, he becomes an alley fill player. Okay, our free safety will read our strike. Okay, if our strike is doing a great job and forcing that play to the inside and our backer is remaining inside out, that alley becomes nice and clear for our free safety. We always want to talk about option responsibility. And when we do talk about option, remember we said the strike has the pitch, and we always want two on the quarterback. So many times this guy, depending on the blocking schemes, that will dictate who we have on option. So if this Sam is getting a down block and he's bending, then actually he's going to take the dive, okay, the veer. This back is going to work his way over the top and take quarterback under. Okay, he's going to work inside out of the quarterback, and this free safety will have quarterback over. And then we have the strike with pitch. So we've got two guys on the quarterback and the strong safety on pitch. And this is how we install our coverage. You know, every coverage that we put it up against option. And I think that's why we've been successful in stopping the run for the last 4 years. Now, if this strike, as you said, forces the issue and hits it so deep in the backfield, okay, then this free safety will overlap. Again, go opposite the strike, and now he'll take that bounce to the outside and really rally to it, and that's when you get the great pursuit and everything that you see on films. So again, by him forcing the issue, he's never wrong, okay? He's never wrong. He'd be wrong going upfield and saying he has contained. But once he starts forcing the issue here, okay, if our free safety can take the overlap and bounce and rally to the football, okay? So that's his job as far as run support. I want to read number two. Okay, I am also an inside-out player, okay? The great thing that we talk about when you have run defense and pursuit drills every day that we do is we talk about ball relationship, and we have people. Our inside linebackers and our free safety are inside-out players. Our strike and whip are outside linebackers. They are outside-in players, as well as our corners. They are outside-in players. So when you have this great converge or this great pursuit on the football, for good run-stopping defense, okay? If it's an inside run type of play, okay, he'll sit there and bounce and bounce and ensure that he's reading number two. Number two's blocking, and he'll work his way for anything that squeezes through our inside linebackers. Again, he is an inside-out player. He's not flying to get out of there. He's going to work his way in tandem of fitting off the backer and inside the strike. Any type of weak side run, we are usually in great shape here because we're one up on the offense. Okay, if they want to run any type of toss, okay, he's going to force the issue. If they're going to run any type of stretch play, again, he's going to force the issue. If there's any type of option, he would have pitch. He would be a little bit later on his alley fill, but again, he's certainly an extra player. He'd work his way over and take on the play. If we're facing some type of option onto this weak side, dive option. Okay, again, it's going to be determined by the way they block. If he's going to block down on our Mac and he's nice and tight, he'll take dive, he'll take quarterback, he'll work his way over to quarterback, and he'll take pitch. Okay, as you see in our defense, we do have 9 people involved against the run. Our 2 corners, they're really not involved against the run unless they get into a crack situation, and now I'll go over cornerback play. Basically, against the run, okay, our corners are 2x9, and they're backpedaling, and against their run, they're half the field defenders. Okay, they're half the field defenders. Okay, okay, he's a robber. Okay, so they're really reading routes. Okay, they're reading routes. They're not reading lane of ball. Some of them can. If they can at 9 yards, that's fine with us. Okay, we want them to read this number one receiver, though. Okay. Because if it is a pass, they will communicate all the routes. They're deep half players. They'll maintain their inside-out leverage. Okay, our corners, they're inside. Number one, their main job is not to allow the offense to run a post pattern up the middle seam. Okay? They want to push, they want to stay, maintain their inside leverage. We'll have our outside foot back, our inside foot up so that they can maintain pushing off the outside to stem inside that number one receiver. They will communicate all routes to the underneath coverage. Okay, they will be overlap players against the run, okay, which we just talked about. They are basically vice players. They get depth and then they vice everything in. They are save men. We don't want our corners involved in any type of tackles. The only time we'll get involved is that teams see our outside linebackers making such plays, they will start to go in motion and crack, or they'll just crack on the snap of the ball, okay, onto our outside linebackers. It's a great, our corners must yell, crack, 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 come up and replace. So once we get our drop, we see him crack, we yell, crack, 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 we will replace. And many times when we hear a crack call, the free safety will just start getting a little bit more depth, okay, because our outside linebackers on crack are taught to turn their backs and beat it. Our corners replacing, we just want to ensure that we don't get the crack and go. And so the free safety will just look for that when he hears crack call. And that's basically run defense in the eight-man front versus cover eight. We're in cover eight. That's our base coverage. We just talked about the run support. It is evolved on the coverage of cover eight, which is our robber type coverage. That's our first down call. That's a power run football. That's a first down call. We don't know if it's a run or pass. It's a good second and medium call when it's a run pass down. Cover eight is one of those calls. We do have, just for inside linebackers to know, some of the rules that are in cover eight. Our backer will always align to passing strength unless it's a balanced formation, it's a one-back balanced formation. You know, when it's a two and one set, two receivers on one side, one on the other, he'll be at passing strength. If they were to take this one back and put it here, and it's a three and one set, okay, he goes to passing strength. But if it were a balanced set, okay, a balanced set, if it was one back and they took this guy and put him over here, he would be away from passing strength. And that's, you know, part of the defense that we won't talk too much about, because this year, if we saw one back set, we probably wouldn't be in G8. We would just probably move this guy back, this whip back, into a two deep look, all right? And we just shift over our linebackers just a half a shade over, and we'd be in our 4-2-5 look, where we can run a lot of our cover two stuff. So I'll try to stay away from the one back split sets versus cover eight, because there are some liabilities. When you do see one back in the eight-man front, you're kind of limited what you can do. You can be in cover three, which is fine, but you're not going to live with that too long versus spread offenses. You could be in a man-free type of situation. We have some different man-free coverages that we run. Again, they're fine to stay in that for 45 snaps of one-back offense. Might be a little bit tough for you to do. So we do get into our 4-2-5 look, where we'll move the whip back and play almost a cover two shell, which is very effective with this defense. They are predominantly hook curl players, okay? What we do say, though, is that the backer is a little bit more of a shallow, tighter dropper. He won't get as much width. Okay, he'll be a little bit more shallower, and he'll stay a little bit tighter inside the box, because we do have a robber working that whole area. The Mac linebacker, we call, is a deeper dropper. Okay, he's shallow. He's a little bit deeper and wider, because, as you see, he'd be responsible for predominantly the dig, the backside dig, that passing lane. So they're basically hot curl droppers, although he'll be a little bit more shallower, he'll be a little bit more deep. Okay, now our strike and whip. Again, if it's pass, we've determined, what do they do next? They read lane of ball, okay, then they get to number two. Number two is their read. In this case, it's from inside out, okay? So what we would be reading here is number two. If number two is out, if he takes an outside move, he becomes mine man to man. He's mine. If he runs an out, I've jumped him, I've got him. If he runs a wheel, okay, I stay with the wheel. Okay, once he makes an outside move, he's mine. If number two goes vertical, okay, if he sees number two releasing vertical, all right, The free safety will say vertical, vertical, vertical. He'll take him. The strike, as soon as he sees a vertical call, he runs underneath number one. That's his job. You get a vertical, okay? Many times you try to break the habit, they try to sit on that vertical, okay? It's not their route. It's not their responsibility. As soon as you see vertical, break to number one. He's probably doing some type of hitch or smash route, okay? If number two goes in, number two's in, okay, get underneath number one. Okay, so if he goes vertical or in, run to one. If he comes out, he's yours, man to man. And if he runs the wheel, you've got him. Can't be more simpler than that. Okay, our free safety, okay, he's also reading number two. If number two goes vertical, he's his, man to man. He's got him, man to man. What determines what a vertical is to our free safety? It's what you determine it on the scouting report, on the routes that you face. Our offense, they know we're reading that vertical. They'll run a little tight end, SAM route at 5.5 yards, okay? And if we determine that it was 8 yards, they'll complete that pass all the time. So we've determined that it's a 6 yard, 5.5 yard rule for our free safety to determine vertical. So if he ran 6 yards and then happened to do an out, our free safety would stay with him, okay? Because he determined that as a vertical. Once he's a vertical, he's yours man to man. You stick with him. Give a vertical call. By giving a vertical call, you have told the backer, you're leaving a little bit of an area open because I'm gone with this vertical. Look for the curl. Okay, again, if they want to run this vertical, run the safety off and run this little curl here, you've got to give that backer a vertical call. Say, hey, I'm not robbing number one. That curl lane's open. Get a little bit more width now because I'm gone with the vertical. Okay, if number two runs out, okay, number two doesn't out, then I'm going to rob number one. Okay, this is where our big hits come. Okay, this is where the picks come. Okay, number two's running an out route. The quarterback may think they're seeing cover three. That strike is expanding with number two out because he takes a man-to-man. He thinks that whole lane is going to be open, and that's when the free safety jumps in front and robs number one for a touchdown. Now, you do have to worry about routes. Okay, some of these guys are getting smart with cover eight. They're running a vertical like this and then stemming him back inside. So your free safety has to be aware. That's another reason why we've moved him back to 12 yards so that he kind of has a comfort zone of a better chance of reading routes. We thought he's still making plays in the run game, and now he's now reading these routes a little bit more clear. Okay, now with number two runs in, okay, if number two runs an in route, you're going to get some depth. Look like you're playing this post route, but you're really going to look backside. And that's the route we want to rob, okay, is that backside dig. So the free safety, number two's vertical, man-to-man vertical call. Number two's out, rob one. Number two goes in, get underneath number one, look like you're playing that post pattern, and then turn around and then rob that dig. The corner play, okay, corners again. They're responsible for not allowing that post pattern, okay? And I don't want to belittle it because I think it's a real hard job. Everybody wants to run that post. Everybody wants to run the post. They're going to double move you to that post. And he's a deep half defender. So as he's pushing off and maintaining his inside leverage on that post route, if they're going to run a post, he wants to be in a situation where they have to run real shallow to our underneath coverage, okay? That's why he's got to maintain that inside leverage. The weak part of the defense, okay, if you're going to tell me it, is that post corner area, okay? But we feel that that's the hardest throw for a quarterback to make is that post corner, okay? So if they do run around that post corner, he's going to take the post, maintain it. They stick that post corner. We're going to speed turn it. We're going to speed turn it. We're going to throw our elbow back, point our toe to the goal line, throw our elbow back, put our chin on our shoulder. And like a center fielder in baseball, speed turn and take that post corner. All right, that's a difficult throw for him to make. We spend a lot of time on that speed turn with our drills with our defensive backs because we know how important it is to be able to get great technique to catch up to play that ball. Okay, but our corners are both deep half defenders. Many times they'll overlap and help each other out on backside routes because they're so deep and they're pinching the outside defenders. It's important that they communicate all routes. If I'm getting an out route, I want to tell that outside linebacker, out, 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 so that outside linebacker can break to it and I will break on top of it. I want to be in a situation where I can assist and overlap other players. If we were to move this defense around, let's put a more stressful formation up just to defend in our cover eight. Again, I won't put one back out because we probably won't be in one back versus cover eight. We want to be, it's a two back set situation. Here, here number two is removed. Okay? We're in cover eight. Again, our inside linebackers are basically hook the curl. Our backer would look for number three coming out and hug him up. Okay, our Mac, in this situation, if two wanted to run a vertical, okay, the backer would have three vertical and the Mac would have two vertical. All right, they would give stress calls in this situation, telling the corners that they're in a bad situation. Make sure you get some depth. Now, here's a route that we want to talk about. You got to take it from the strike. The strike reads number two. He's going out. He's going to run with that wheel route. Okay? The free safety, he's reading number two. Number two is going out. He's going to what? Rob number one. So he's going to react on that route. The corner is maintaining inside leverage, and he's going to get depth, and he's going to overlap both routes. So you're getting three defenders on two routes. Okay? Backside, depending on what he's doing. Okay, is that the backside route? If he wants to occupy that, the corner is going to say out, out, out. The whip will break on that, and he'll be able to get some depth and assist if this Mac gets a run through by number two vertical. Okay, if he's running a post corner, he'll play the post corner. If he's running a post route, he's going to squeeze it, squeeze it, squeeze it. Many times he'll help out on the backside route. All right, so you can see how we can treat this this little stressful situation with three people covering the wheel route, okay, the switch route here. And it's been a good robber coverage for us. Again, predominantly a two-back set where we're not getting too much stress on the inside linebackers. This is what we want to be in our robber coverage, cover eight. All right, here we are again. We have another slot formation, eye strong slot. Again, we did call eight cloud. Try to roll up our corners to take care of the slot game. The rest of us down here are playing cover eight. You'll see them try to run counter to this side. A big play for people when they see us roll our coverage to that side in the eight-man front is to try to run something backside. You'll see our seven technique that we talked about. He sees a down dock by the tackle. He's going to squeeze it and bend. And he does a great job of not getting washed all the way downfield by the tight end. We have our linebacker here that has a great read. He's going to trigger, read counter, and come and fit right off of our defensive end's heels. Okay, we have our outside linebacker that's doing a nice job of being patient and not pressing the line of scrimmage, reading the lane of ball in the two lane. He's prepared for this ball to bounce outside. Okay, our end bends. Our outside linebacker is right there for any type of outside bounce. And now we just have the backside pursuit people running to the football to make the play. It is versus a two-back set, except they're taking the fullback and they're just kind of moving him to a wing. What we do, if you look at our alignment, we still have our seven technique to the tight end side, our three, our one, and our five. We have our backer in a 40-I and our Mac in a 10 technique. We have our whip. He's in our hip position. He's still outside the wing. He looks like he's maybe 3 yards because it is a wing. So he's 3 yards instead of the 4 yard rule. Okay, our corner, okay, he doesn't have a wide out, he has a wing, so he's 1x9 inside that wing. Our free safety is in the B gap to passing strength. Our backside corner is a 1x9 situation on the wide out. Okay, they want to run a little zone scheme up front with the belly to the one back set. Again, we wouldn't be out of cover eight. This is not a spread formation for us. We feel that we're in a good situation in our cover eight robber coverage for run support. We have our defensive line doing a good job on the combo blocks. Here's our three technique, not getting pushed, our seven technique not getting pushed. We're doing a good job. Our linebacker's playing it tough with his hands in there. We've got backside press. What I like most on this player is our backside one technique, the way he just comes off the ball. All right, again, they're trying to single block him and combo this way. We have to declare, you know, our nose guard must get a combo on him. If he doesn't get a combo on him, we want him to do a good job of making the play. And there he actually splits a combo. We've got great press techniques by our linebacker, and we get great pursuit to the football. This is I slot. We're in our blow sting look. Very simply, we did it before. It looks like up G to us. Our linebacker lines head up, and he works his way inside late. Threat of a blitz. Blow sting, both outside linebackers are coming. They give meet calls to the defensive end. Meet calls tells the end to go into the B gap, so they have room to blitz. Our free safety has number two strong. Sting coverage tells them to take two strong. Our corners have number one, and our linebackers are responsible for three strong, two weak. Okay, here we have one of the great things about running this G front is they've taken their fullback and now they've put him to a wing. Okay, we are in our cover eight alignment. However, we're in a hug look. Actually, this is an up look. What we can do when we're in our G defense is use the same front. Everybody's aligned the same way. We can move our outside linebackers up to the line of scrimmage and call it up G. Okay, we can move all four linebackers, one, two, three, four, up to the line of scrimmage on the heels of the defensive lineman. We call that hug G. Okay, and we can take just the two inside linebackers and put them in up and have these guys off and play tug G so that we have a different looks of our front. We don't have to worry about moving our defensive line and stemming it much because there's such a blitz awareness of all these players being in a blitz situation. Now here is one of our basic blitzes. It is called to us up G, two outside linebackers, up G, blow sting. That's both outside linebackers coming. Okay, sting is the coverage. It's just a zero coverage. Our corners are locked up on number one, okay? Our free safety goes to number two passing strength, and our inside linebackers take number two weak and number three strong. This is up G blow sting. Again, here they come, all right? They give me calls to the defensive ends, which tell them to come underneath these end calls. And it's another great easy blitz for the run support game, up G blow sting. I hope we've been helpful to you on this instructional tape. Again, I think if you decide that you want to stop the run, if that's something you need to do, if you're facing multiple offenses that run option, wing T, defending the run, power run game, okay, with a little bit of play action pass and bootleg, an eight-man front has always worked for us. It gives us great coverage. It's robber coverage. It allows a ninth man in the box. People are talking about trying to get the eighth and ninth man in the box. Well, we're getting ninth men in the box with people rallying to the football. If we could be any assistance to you in your future of installing this defense or just talking football, please give us a call at CW Post College.